This morning, I want to talk to you about called to purpose. What is the theme for this month? Do you remember the theme for this month? What? Growing in purpose. So we've been talking about purpose all through this month, right? You are part of the puzzle. You are what? You matter. What else? Growing together. We have been talking in purpose. So today I'm going to talk about called to purpose. What is purpose? Purpose is the reason for which something exists, or the reason why something was made or something was done. So I want you to pray while you are seated. Close your eyes, please. Talk to God. Oh Lord, open my eyes of understanding this morning in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth, begin to talk to God. Talk to God right now. Pray. Lord, open my eyes of understanding this morning. Open my eyes of understanding this morning. Thank you, Father. Open my eyes of understanding. Show me my purpose. Speak to me. Challenge me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Someone say, call to purpose. Come on, say it. Call to purpose. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And we know that all things, how many things? Come on, try it again. How many things? Come on, try it again. How many things? For we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. We know that all things work together for good to them that what? Love God. And to them that are called according to his purpose. So one of the first things you will understand from that scripture is that in order for you to make sure everything that happened to you work for your own good, you must do what? Love God. And you must be called. Amen? Now, you cannot love God if you are not called. Because the Bible says, nobody comes to me except I draws them near. So it is God that is drawing your heart. It is God that impacted you with your love. Bible says, with the love you have for him. The Bible says God is the one that walk in us to what? Will and do of his good pleasure. So it is God that walk in us to will and to do. In other words, God is the one that orchestrated his love inside you to will, to desire, to will, and then to do is good pleasure. In other words, it is God that put in your heart to love him. It is God that inspired you to come to church. It is God that makes you want to read the Bible. It is God that makes you want to please him. It is God that works in you to will it, to want to do it. It is God that works in you to will and to do of his good, of God's pleasure. So you cannot love God without God calling you in the first place. So if you love God, it's a sign that you are called. Tell somebody, I'm called. Ask your neighbor, do you love God? Come on. Ask your neighbor, do you love God? Ask them seriously, do you really love God? Then tell them, then you are called. Now, if you love God, it means you are called. If you are called, it means everything happening to you is working for your own good. That's a good place to shout. If you love God, it means you are called. If you are called, it means everything. Somebody say everything. Every little thing. Every big thing. Every medium thing, every large thing, all things. It means all things work together for your own good. Everything. What you seem to not like, what is uncomfortable, what you don't expect, what you wish has not happened, even those things that happen that you do not desire to happen, God will take them and use it for your good. As long as you love God. So you can look at the devil and laugh at the devil. Even when the devil thought he killed Jesus, the Bible says, if the gods of this world, if the priests of this world, they have known, they wouldn't have killed the Lord of glory. Even the killing of Jesus ended up leading to the redemption of man. Hallelujah. So you can relax. Tell somebody relax. Come on, relax. Come on, tell them relax. Come on, take it easy. Tell them relax. God is using every situation. Joseph says, what you guys plan for evil, God has turned it for good. You know why? Because Joseph loved God and was called to God's purpose. Because you have to think about it. If Joseph was not loved by his father, his father would not have given him. Okay, no, let's walk all the way back. If Jacob, his father, did not love Rachel, Joseph's mother, right? Joseph will not have been born. Because Jacob could have given up on Rachel long ago when Laban deceived Joseph by giving him Leah instead of Rachel. So watch this. Laban has to mess Jacob up for Jacob to work so hard to get Rachel. And when, watch this, when Jacob got Rachel, he has paid 7 years of labor. So he loved Rachel before. But guess what? Now he loved her more. Because some stuff that you get for free, you don't appreciate. Somebody got married, and the night of their wedding, she got pregnant. So the baby came 9 months later. The first time the baby cried, he said, what is your problem? Shut up, boy. I want to sleep. And then somebody got married. And 2 years, no child. 3 years, no child. 4 years, no child. 10 years, no child. 15 years, no child. Then 16 years, she got pregnant. And then the baby came. And the first night the baby cried, what do you think she did? Praising the Lord. She was dancing for the cry of the baby that woke her up at night. Because the guy that had, or the lady that had the baby at first night of marriage loved the child. But the one that had the baby 16 years later, guess what? Love the bad child even more. So the frustration that Jacob went through by the deception of Laban made Jacob love Rachel even more. Because not only that, he was deceived to get Rachel. After he got Rachel, Rachel was barren for years. And the fourth child that Rachel had was Joseph. Guess why Joseph became Jacob's favorite child? All the delay, all the frustration, all the deception, all worked into the love of Jacob for his son, Joseph. If Laban has not deceived Jacob, Jacob wouldn't have had to work 7 extra years plus another 7 years, which make it 14 years to get Rachel. And if Rachel has not had delay in childbearing, the value of the child that Rachel had wouldn't have been great as it was after she had Joseph. If the value is not that high, Joseph will not have become Jacob's favorite child. If Joseph was not Jacob's favorite child, Jacob wouldn't have sewn or made for Joseph the cloth with many colors. If Jacob has not made Joseph the cloth with many colors, which made it obvious his favorite child, the brothers wouldn't have hated him. And when Joseph began to have dreams, not only that the brother hated him, Joseph said, guess what? I had a dream. And the chiefs, my chiefs, were standing, and yours were all bowing before my chiefs. I said, guess what? I had another dream. And my star was standing, and your stars were bowing before my stars. I saw 13 stars. I saw 13 stars, and those 11 of those 13 stars are you guys bowing before me. The remaining two is mom and dad. So you are all bowing before me. And the more he told them his dream, the more they hated him. I mean, do you know how much hatred you have to have for your... I mean, some of you don't like your brother. You know the truth. But you don't like them to the extent that you want to kill them, man. I mean, they have to hate him to the point whereby they wanted to kill him. I mean, you don't mind slapping your brother sometimes and pretend you didn't slap him, you know. You don't mind, you know, setting them up for trouble and tell mom they did it and they get in trouble. But if they get in trouble, you start crying. But when you hate your brother to the point where you want to kill him, they hated Joseph so much that they wanted to kill Joseph. And they needed, listen, Joseph needed that level of hatred in order for them to deal what they did to him. Someone say all things. Somebody say all things. Come on, somebody say all things. Come on, somebody say all things. All things work together for good to them that love God. If your boss have not fired you, you won't have started your business. If that girl has not dropped you, you won't have married your wife. If you have not lost that job, you won't have gotten the other job. If you have not lost that house, you won't have gotten your dream home. All things work together for good to them that love God. Amen. All things. If they have not hated him so much, they wouldn't have thrown him in the pit. If they have not thrown him in the pit, he wouldn't have been sold into slavery. If they have not sold him into slavery, he wouldn't have ended up in Potiphar's house. If he hasn't ended up in Potiphar's house, he wouldn't have met Potiphar's wife. If he hasn't met Potiphar's wife, the woman wouldn't have fallen in love with him. If the woman has not fallen in love or lost with him, she wouldn't have set him up for trouble. If she has not set him up for trouble, he wouldn't have ended up in prison. If he hasn't ended up in prison, he would have met the butler. If he hadn't met the butler, he wouldn't have ended up in Pharaoh's palace. If he hasn't ended up in Pharaoh's palace, he wouldn't have become the prime minister. All things. It's a long process, but it's all working for your own good. Tell somebody it's a long process. Come on, tell somebody this is taking a whole long time. But I tell you something, tell them, I tell you something. This is working. Come on, tell them, this is working. Tell them, all this is working together for my good. So the Bible says, all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. So, as long as you love God, as long as you are called, everything is working together for your own good. It means you are called to his purpose. And what I want you to pay attention to this morning is that call to purpose. Is that call to purpose? What is purpose? Purpose is the reason for which something was made, or the reason for which something was created, or the reason for which something exists. You have a purpose. God did not just create you and try to figure out why he created you in the first place. God has a plan from the onset. From the beginning, God has a plan for you. God doesn't make mistakes. God has never made mistakes with you. You are exactly where you're supposed to be. You are exactly what you're supposed to be. You are doing exactly what you are meant to do. God sees the end before the beginning. God knew at this point you are going to be where you are right now at this moment. Hey, God knew. Tell somebody God knew. Come on, tell somebody. Don't look at me like that. God knew where I am. God knew exactly where I am right now. God knew. You thought I made a mistake, but God knew. You thought I messed up, but God knew. You thought I should have done it in a different way, but guess what? God knew. You are called to a purpose. God has a plan for your life. God has an agenda. God has you on his schedule. If you look at God's diary, your name is there. You are on God's tablet. You are on God's iPhone. And the notepad of God has your name written on it. You are so special to God. God has your life planned out ahead of you. But you have to understand that you are called to a purpose. That you are not here by accident. You are not here by mistake. That even the people that turn against you and the people that said those stuff about you, people that left you, you should thank God for people that left you. Tell them, na, 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 na. You send them a postcard. Thank you for leaving. I wish you stayed, but I'm glad you left. Hey! Yay! Thank you for firing me. I don't want to go, but I needed to be fired. Some of the greatest things that need to happen in your life are some of the most painful things. And if God has to fulfill his purpose in your life, those things have to happen. Some people have to die for you to live. Some people have to go for you to enter into your destiny. Some people have to leave you for you to find your own people. Somebody has to walk out on your job for your best worker to walk in. Some of you needed to lose everything you have in order to learn to trust God. Some of you had it so quick, so fast, so easy, you don't appreciate it. So God allowed the devil to take it away so that you know what it takes to get it. Now you can teach others. You can tell others, I've been down, look at me, I'm back up. All things. I say all things. I say all things. Work together for good. As long as you are called, all things is working together for you. As long as you love God, if you can check your heart and you can sense the love of God, then you are in God's plan. You don't know it all. You don't fully understand it. You can't fully explain it, but all things work together for good. The delay, there are some delays. They are divine delays. There are some delays. They are divine delays. God will divinely keep you back to explode you. Because if you go too fast, you will burn up. So God will keep you back and you're like, God, come on, let me go. I bind you the devil. And God said, I'm not the devil. I'm the one holding you. I'm God holding you. But this is not the devil. Shut up, boy. He's not the devil. This is God. And God will just hold on to you and you will fast and you pray. And God said, keep fasting, keep praying. That is piling up in your bank. You need this, but I'm the one holding you back at this point. All things work together for good to them that are called. Can I ask you a question? Are you called? Yes. Come on. Are you called? Yes. Are you called? Yes. Are you called? Yes. Then all things work together for you. Because you have a divine God-ordained purpose. There is a reason why you are here. You are called to purpose because of who you are. You are not nobody. You are somebody. Tell somebody, I am not nobody. Tell them, I don't look like much to you. Come on, tell them, I don't look like much to you, but I am not nobody. I don't look that cute to you, but I'm not nobody. I'm not wearing the most expensive dress, but I'm not nobody. My shoe is not $1 million, but I am not nobody. Tell them, I'm not no nobody. Tell them, I am somebody. Some of you have been told all your life that you are nobody, that you are no good, that you are not going to make it, that you are going to fail. Tell yourself, I am somebody. The reason why God called you into his purpose is because you are somebody. It's because of who you are. Who are you? You are God's image on earth. You are God's picture on earth. You are God's frame. You are God's shape on earth. Why are you so important? Because, watch this, of your body. I will teach you about your body today and next week. Do you know that the most important asset you have to fulfilling, watch this now, this is important. If you are taking note, write this down. The most important asset you have to fulfilling your purpose on the earth, the emphasis on the earth, is your body. It is not your spirit. You have no spirit. You are a spirit. Do you hear what I just said? You have no spirit. You are a spirit. You yourself, the you, the real you, is a spirit. So you don't have a spirit. You are a spirit. You have a soul. Watch this. And you live inside a body. But we have disrespected the body so long, so I'm here to advocate for the body. I'm body advocate this morning. The reason why you are so special is because you are God's image on earth. And the most important thing about you is your physical body. You know why? Because your body, watch this, is your earthly suit. It's your earthly suit. It's what keeps you relevant on earth. Your body is your earthly license. It's your earthly papers, earthly documents. It's what makes you legal on earth. You are a spirit. You have a soul. And you live inside your body. Without your body, you cannot fulfill the plan of God for your life. Without your poor body, you cannot fulfill destiny. Without your body, is a Marie God said. Without your body, you cannot walk on the face of the earth and fulfill destiny. You know, the last leg of this trip I had, we went from Lagos to Tanzania, Arusha. And when we got to Arusha, there was another pastor coming with me, connected with me in Lagos. We got to Tanzania. We flew on Monday, 6th, from Lagos to Tanzania. We went to Kenya Airways, and Kenya Airways dropped us at Nairobi, Kenya Airport, at 7:30. And the flight from Kenya to Tanzania is only 1 hour, but they won't take us. They kept us there for over 12 hours. So we slept or sat at the airport for over 12 hours, just waiting to take an hour flight to Tanzania. So by the time we got to Tanzania, it was around 9:30, 10. We were so tired, we were so beat up. We've been flying since the day before, for over 24 hours. And when we got there, it's a long story, I got in, gave them my papers. But the pastor that came with me, they won't let him into the country because he didn't have his papers. Oh, in the past, he has traveled and he just get to the point of entry and he will pay some money and they will give him a visa, a document to go inside. But for some reason, this time, they said no. They said, you can't enter this country because you are illegal. You don't have your papers. And they kept us there for about 3 hours. We didn't leave there till about 12, 1 o'clock. Without those papers, we had to make phone calls. We had to bring somebody in to help. Long story. Until they gave him his papers, it was not legal to enter into the country. Your papers is your body on earth. If you don't have your papers, you are illegal. You can't stay here. So you are a spirit. You have a soul. You live inside a body. That is why whenever your body expires, you are out of here. That's what we call death. Are you listening to me? Whenever your body expires, when your paper is expired, you can't stay. That is what we call death. A dead person is a person whose body has expired on earth. Did you hear what I just said? That is why when you see a dead person, you can see the dead body and they say he's gone. Once that body is expired, the spirit has to leave. So without your body, you cannot function right here on the earth. I want to explain to you why you are called to purpose. Why you, I'm trying to watch, just pay attention. Why you are so important. Why God has to call you. It's because you are the image of God. And I remember, God is a spirit. Even God, watch this, even God cannot do anything on earth without a body. So when God wanted to do something, you know what he did? He entered into a body. We call him Jesus. Christ never died. You know who died? Jesus. Jesus died. Christ never died. Christ is the Messiah. Christ is the Spirit of God. He never died. In order for Christ to win the world, to change the world, he needed the body of Jesus. So we call him Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus had to come through Mary, through human body. Are you getting this? So you needed a body. Even God needed a body. Guess what? Even the devil needed a body. When the devil went to perform business on earth, guess what he did? He went to the serpent and he borrowed a body. That's why God told the serpent, you will never walk upright again. You will crawl on your belly. Do you know that the snake used to walk upright? The snake used to walk upright. It was God punishing the snake that says, listen, you will never stand upright again. You're going to walk on your belly because you did business with the devil and you allowed the devil to use your body. Because the devil is a spirit. That is why demons try to possess people. That's why I see people that are demon-possessed. Because demons cannot function on earth without a body. Because they don't have anybody. The physical, legal document to function on earth is body. So your most important asset on earth is your body. So take care of your body. Oh, good preaching. Thank you. Because once your body is gone, you are no good. Have you ever wondered why God never intervened when the devil was tempting Eve? Have you ever wondered? Because God cannot do anything, watch this, will not do anything on earth without permission. Let me show you. Are you here with me? Psalm 115, verse 15 to 17. Psalm 115, verse 15 to 17. Psalm 115, verse 15 to 17. Ye are blessed, ye are blessed of the Lord, which made heaven and earth. The heaven, even the heavens are the Lord's. Look at it. But the earth are the word given to the children of men. He said, the dead praise not the Lord, neither any that go down into Sodom. In other words, once you are dead, you can't even praise God. In other words, you need your body. What is dead? Dead is the separation of your spirit from your body. And once your spirit and your body are separated, it means the body has expired, the spirit has to leave. And the Bible says that dead body cannot praise God. So it says, the heaven is for God and the earth is for the sons of men. In other words, God has given the earth to man. Because the earth is a physical place. And you need a physical body to operate on earth. That's why we are spirit, and our spirit is not good enough to function on earth. So God gave us a soul and put it inside a physical body. That's why the devil wants to destroy your body with cancer and sickness and disease and high blood pressure. That is the devil trying to delegitimize you, to make you illegal or not, to get rid of you so that you cannot affect him anymore. You remember the story of the demon possessed that Jesus Christ met and cast out the devil, and the devil began to beg Jesus, don't cast us out. Okay, if you can't do anything, just send us into what? A pig, into pigs. Because they needed a physical body. If, let me tell you, the human body is their mansion. But if they can't get the mansion, they will get the shark house. The pig's body, the cat body, the snake body, the dog's body. The reason why you are so special, watch this. The reason why you are so special to God is because of your body. God wants to change the world. He needs your body. God wants to move mountain. He needs your body. God wants to destroy the works of darkness. He needs your body. That's why the Bible says, whatsoever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. God needs a human physical body binding on earth so that he can step in to bind in heaven. Is this making sense to you? Is this making any sense to you? I want you to see this. He says, the heaven has he given to God. God has kept the heaven to himself, but the earth he has given to the sons of men. Now, I want to show you something very interesting. Genesis chapter 1. We are going to read from verse 25. But if you look at Genesis chapter 1, if you are writing that, you can write this down. Genesis chapter 1, verse 11 to 13, talk about the third day. In the third day, God created the grass, the trees, and the fruit. From verse 14 to 19 is the fourth day. And God created sun and the moon. From 20 to 23 is the fifth day. And God created the fishes, or the fish, and the birds. Day one, day two, God separated the heaven from the earth, the land, the sea, and all that stuff. He created the atmosphere, the environment before the storm. Remember that? He created the firmament before the stars. He created the water before the fish. He created the ground before the trees, right? I thought about that. He created Eden before man. So he created all these things. And then on the sixth day, God created the animals and he created man. Look at verse 25 now. Look at verse 25. I want to show you something as we close. I'm going to have to round up now. Continue next week. And God made the beast of the earth. Are you here with me? Verse 25, and God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was what? Good. Look at verse 26. And God said, let us make man in our what? Image. This is why you are so important. You are God's image on the earth. Let us make man in our own image and after our likeness, and let them have what? Dominion over the fish of the sea. Watch that. Let them. Not let us. Remember, it says let us create man, but let them, man, have dominion. God gave dominion to man. He excluded himself. He gave the authority on the earth to you and I, man. The heaven is for the Lord, and the earth has he given to the sons of man. That is it right there. Let them, man, have what? Dominion. So you are the one that has dominion. What makes you relevant to God? What makes you so special to God is that you are the one that has the authority on the earth. God has given the authority on the earth to man. A great man, John Wesley, once said, it seems to me that without God, man cannot. But without man, God will not. God can do anything. God is sovereign. God is omnipotent God, omniscient God, omnipresent God. But that God has chosen to stay in heaven and give the earth to the sons of men. This is why you are called to purpose today. You are the one that, watch this, you are the one that have dominion on earth. Say, let them have, let them. He excluded himself. Let them have dominion, what? Over the fish of the sea. Remember, verse 11, 12, 13 to 25, everything he created. He says, I've created everything. Let the man I created on the sixth day have dominion over everything. He now began to name them the fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, over the fourth thing I created on the first day, second day, third day, fourth day. Let this man that I created on the sixth day have dominion over all. How many? All what? The earth. Over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his image, and in the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. What am I trying to show you this morning? You are called to dominate the earth. You are called to walk in authority on the earth. You are called to decree for it to be established on the earth. You are called to prosper, to be wealthy, to be rich, so that you can influence the event on the earth. You are called to power, to prayer, to purpose. You are called to add value to the earth. Waiting for God to do it is a mistake. It is you and I that God has ordained to change the world by his power. But God needs you and I to do it. If you and I do nothing, nothing happens. That is why children of God should walk in close relationship with God so that God can constantly download the latest update into their lives in order to know what God expects to be done on earth. That is why the children of God needs to stay in the Garden of Eden, in God's presence, so that they can be up to date with God's assignments for their lives. That's why the children of God needs to remember that without them, the earth will be destroyed. That's why God says, I look for somebody to stand in the gap, and nobody stands in the gap. I need human body. I need people to use. I need people to help. We are the one that God is going to use to change the world. It's not anybody coming from anywhere. We are called to purpose. As we go on in this sermon next week, I will start showing you specifics. You are called to be healthy because God needs your body to function. Not that it cannot function without you, but he has chosen not to without you. You are called to prosper because the Bible says, "To prosperity shall my city be spread abroad." A poor church is a grounded church. You are called to be healthy so that you can be the leg of God, the hand of God, the eyes of God, the mouth of God. You are called to prayer so that you can move mountains and change the world. You are called to love so that you can be God's representation in the life of people around you. That is why Christians must refuse to buy into the enemy's deception. Rise up on your feet.